What's up, geeks, and welcome to the channel. Our trees journey started by introducing binary search trees, and a couple of videos later we tackled their height increase problem by transforming them into self-balancing binary search trees, such as AVL trees and red-black trees. However, if we need to store large amounts of data, the self-balancing property will not be enough to prevent the huge increase of the tree height. Therefore, we may find ourselves in need to store more than one key or value in a single node. Or we may think that having more than two children per node can help us maintain the height of our tree at a lower level. And that is exactly what B-trees allow us to do. These trees are the generalization of the self-balancing binary search trees we previously covered. So, instead of storing a single key or value or be limited to two children per node, we can fatten this tree as we please, and consequently, we will be reducing its height, making all the operations we learned for binary search trees still applicable and efficient on large amounts of data. So, as we just said, B-trees are self-balancing trees, and a B-tree of order M is, in short, a tree where every node can have at most M children and can store at most M-1 keys or values. Additionally, the smaller greater property we discussed for binary search trees should be satisfied here as well. To dive further into these notions, take this B-tree of order 4 as an example. All the values inside the root's left subtrees are smaller than the root, and all the values inside the root's right subtrees are greater than the root. Now, because a single node can store multiple keys, and in order to respect the smaller greater property we just talked about, then any child node sitting between any two keys should only contain key values that are greater than their preceding key and smaller than their following key. As you can see in this example, the nodes highlighted in red store only elements that are between 10 and 20, or 20 and 30 respectively. In addition to this, and to make everything we previously discussed possible, the elements stored inside the same node should be sorted in ascending order. So the smallest element is stored to the far left side of the node, and the biggest element to the far right side of the node. Okay, everything we said until now is great. However, in order for a tree to be declared as a valid B-tree of order M, it should satisfy three additional properties. The first one is that, with the exception of the root, every non-leaf node, also known as internal nodes, should have at least ceiling of M over two child nodes. So the tree you see in front of you is a valid B-tree of order 3, because each of its internal nodes has at least two children, 2 being the ceiling of 3 divided by 2. The reason behind this property lies within one of the main features of a B-tree we discussed at the beginning of the video, and it is the height shrinking. The ceiling of M over 2 property ensures that each internal node is at least half full, and this relation implies that 2 half-full nodes can be joined to make a legal node, and that 1 full node can be split into 2 legal nodes. This will turn out to be very useful when inserting and or deleting elements from a B-tree. We will expand on this further while discussing the insert and delete operations. Now, the second property is a bit more straightforward, as it suggests that if a non-leaf node has n children, then it must contain n-1 keys or values. Take this simple B-tree as an example, and consider that its root node has 4 children nodes. If the root node didn't contain the three elements you see, 10, 20, and 30, how would we know that the elements stored in the first child should be smaller than 10? The ones in the second child should be between 10 and 20, etc. So if we have 4 children, the parent node must have 3 elements or keys stored inside it, or more generally, if we have n children, then the parent must have n-1 keys stored inside it. The last property that a tree should satisfy in order to be a valid B-tree is that all its leaf nodes should appear at the same level of the tree. And if you think about it, that is kind of understandable, given that a B-tree is a self-balancing tree, and that its ultimate goal is to reduce its height in order to speed up the operations we are allowed to execute. Okay, now that we know what a B-tree is, and what are the properties of a B-tree, let's take a look at the operations provided by a B-tree and start with the insert operation. To do that, suppose we have the tree you see in front of you. This is a B-tree of order 3, also known as the 2-3 B-tree. These trees are by far the most popular B-trees out there. Now consider we want to insert the element 28 into this tree. If we start at the root and hop to the left when 28 is bigger than the node we are standing at, or hop to the right when 28 is smaller, as we did for binary search trees, then our element 28 should sit right there in this node colored in red. However, we just mentioned that this is a 2-3B tree, and therefore the maximum number of keys or values each node is allowed to hold is 2. So what we have to do is split this node evenly into two nodes and promote element 25, which is the middle element, to the parent node. In our case, the parent node only contains a single child and has room for the element we just promoted. However, if this parent node already had two elements inside it, then both the splitting and promoting actions should keep going all the way up till we reach the root node. Take a second element as an example, and suppose we want to insert the item 3 as well into this tree. So, this element would normally fit right there in the spot marked in red in front of you. And as we did previously, and because this node already contains two elements, two being M-1, then we have to split it and promote its middle element to the parent node. The middle element is 4 in this case. However, here the parent already contains two elements, so what we do now is split the parent node as well, and promote its middle item to its parent node, which is here the root node of the tree. But the root node appears to be full as well. So what we do is split the current root node, then promote its middle element to a new node, which will be the new root of our tree. After doing this, that is the final tree we obtain, notice how this tree preserves all the B-tree conditions we previously discussed, and hence is a valid B-tree. Okay, now that we inserted a couple of items into our B-tree, let's try to delete a few elements from it. Suppose we want to remove element 30 from the B-tree you can see. 30 here is inside a leaf node, so we can go ahead and just remove it. But what if we also want to delete element 26 from the tree? It is also inside a leaf node, and we can remove it directly. However, if we do that, our tree will not be valid anymore, and its parent node won't have the minimum number of required children. So how do we delete this node? Well, because it is a leaf node, we have to remove it, just like we did for the previous element. But after removing it, what we have to do is balance our B tree to bring all the leaf nodes to the same level. And how do we balance a B tree? With the help of rotations. To fix this tree, we need to look at the immediate siblings of the node we removed. And if one of these siblings contains more than the minimum number of required elements, which if you recall is the ceiling of M/2, then our issue can be solved with a simple left or right rotation. In our case, the left sibling of the removed node contains two elements, which is the maximum. Therefore, we can balance our tree using a right rotation. The rotation is done by copying the separator, or the middle element, from the parent to a new node to its right. So in other terms, the separator moves down to ensure that the new node has the minimum number of elements. Then we have to replace the moved separator in the parent with the last element of the left sibling, or in other terms, the left sibling loses one node but still has at least the minimum number of required elements. Our B-tree is now balanced. Of course, you have the symmetric case, where the right sibling is the one from which we can borrow elements. In this tree, we will encounter such a scenario if we try to delete the element 1, for example. If we do this, we can rebalance our tree using a left rotation. This is done by copying the separator of the parent, 2 in this case, to the newly created node on its left. Then by replacing this separator with the first element of the right sibling, 4 in this example. Now, what if both the right and left sibling contain the minimum number of elements? What are we going to put instead of the node we just removed? Take element 6, for example. If we remove this element from the tree, we will encounter the scenario I was just mentioning. To balance this tree again, we have to merge the children of the parent of the node we just deleted. To do this, we have to copy the middle element of the parent to the end of the left node. And here, we do not care if this node is a newly created node as we have here, or a sibling node with a minimum number of elements. So we can copy the middle element to the beginning of the right node as well. Then what we have to do is move all the elements of the right node in this example to the left node. So the left node has now the maximum number of elements, and the right node is empty. The parent just lost an element, and the tree is now balanced. Okay, until now we have been only deleting leaf nodes from the tree. But what if the node to delete was an internal node? Take node 4 as an example. This node acts as a separation value for its two children subtrees. Therefore, what we need to do is find a replacement for this separation. This replacement can either be the largest element in the left node or the smallest element in the right node. Let's replace it with its left child. Now you should find yourself in a situation similar to the cases we previously covered. Because if you think about it, what we just did is similar to removing an item from a leaf node. So let's proceed by balancing our tree. Notice that the immediate right sibling of the empty node is full. Therefore, we can balance this tree using a left rotation. This rotation is done by bringing up the first element of the right sibling to the parent to act as the new middle item, and by bringing down the old separator of the parent to the end of its left child. Now, with the basic rotation cases and the rebalancing covered, let's take a look at another operation offered by B-trees, and it is searching for an item inside the tree. To do this, we are going to use the B-tree of order 5 you see in front of you. Searching a B-tree is similar to searching a binary search tree. We have to start at the root node, then traverse the tree recursively from top to bottom until we find the element we want. Say we want to retrieve the element having 17 as key. To retrieve this element, we start right at the beginning of the root node, in this example at element 4, and we traverse this node from left to right until we find the element in question or the child node storing elements within the range of this element. In our example, this child node is the one in common between elements 14 and 19. Then the same process is repeated on the child node until we find the element we are seeking and return with it, or until we deduce that the tree does not contain the element we are searching for. The last operation that I want to discuss is traversing a B-tree, specifically the in-order traversal. If you recall, this way of tree traversal will lead to the sorting of the elements inside the tree. And similarly to binary search trees, it is done in a recursive manner, by visiting the left child first, then the parent node, and then the right child. So, if we want to traverse the tree you see in front of you in an in-order manner, we have to start with the node to the far left side of the tree from left to right, then go up to its parent element or separator item, and then visit the right child of this item, which is also the left child of the following parent element. We keep doing this until all the elements of the tree are visited. Okay, now that we are familiar with the B-tree operations, it is time to implement them. However, this video is already heavy and lengthy as it is, so I figured if you guys really want a video detailing the implementation of B-trees in Java, let me know in the comments down below, and I'll make sure to add it to this series as soon as possible. So, that's it for this video. I hope it was helpful. Thank you guys for watching, take care, and I will see you in the next one.